I totally believe that it does, and it's interesting because you're right, Adam McFadden, I just remembered that, that you pointed out, he does address that, and I have no doubt in my mind that the Rochester Police Department, even though there's a black, you know, there's an African-American director being the chief at the helm of the department, I'm convinced that they have, again, going back to the complacent thing, I wouldn't even call it complacent, I would call it just an outright refusal and lack of interest to make things right. So I have no doubt in my mind that they're not actively pursuing any kind of, you know, balance, any kind of, you know, meeting within those guidelines that Adam McFadden mentioned, that were handed down, you know, from the 70s, you know, for hiring more minorities. Immediately when you said that, I had a picture of maybe a year ago, I don't know if other people will remember, I was in traffic somewhere and I was behind a bus, RTS bus, city bus, and in the back of the bus, couldn't miss it, like right in my face, there was a huge billboard announcement for the Syracuse Police Department. And it said something about tough as nails or something, and it had like some nails in the design. And it was basically a minority officer, I believe two minority officers, a nice looking Latina officer, and or whether they were actors dressed as policemen, but you know what I mean, with police uniforms, and a African-American officer. And I was like, wow, it struck me like that's something I've never seen. An actual police department of a city an hour and a half away drive from here advertising on a Rochester bus. And I found it interesting. I thought two things immediately. I thought, wow, they must be really hard up for officers. And then I thought, that was kind of like a tongue-in-cheek joke that I thought to myself. But then I thought seriously, like, wow, you know, I'd be willing to bet here were two minority officers, or like I said, people dressed in officer's uniforms staring at me in their head. And I thought, you know, the Rochester Police Department, that's something they need. Interestingly enough, to be fair here, and not to be called out and say that I left this part out, maybe 3-4 months ago around Broad and Allen Street, I saw a big billboard the first time ever I saw. And this time it was a African-American woman dressed in RPD uniform. Basically saying how great the job is and whatnot, and but it's funny. It's kind of like I went into a little while ago with the Constitution. It's hanging up, but it's not being really implemented. And I'm sure the Chief Shepherd, I would not be surprised, or Mayor Richards would have a response to this, saying that, you know, it's always the same response. Test me on this. Actually, test me on this. Reach out to them, or have the media reach out to them, and compare this that I'm going to say now to their response. It will be somewhere along the line of, it's something that we have struggled to do. We are actively working on it. We are interested. It's definitely in our goal. It's definitely our direction which we want to go in. But it doesn't happen. And by the way, it's not just the RPD. I was in court for one of the Nick Joseph or whatever, Merritt Ron, the disgraced Greece police chief and the officers. And a black, an African-American deputy who has been there for over 25 years stopped me and knows me personally and knows of my work, and very nice man, and wrote me a note. And the note was addressed to Sheriff Patrick O'Flynn of the Monroe County Sheriff's Department. And the note basically said, why are there not more minority officers on the sheriff's patrol office, you know? And this is a question that he wanted me to ask Patrick O'Flynn, which I hate to admit, but I never got around to doing anything about that. So it's not just, you know, I asked this man, I said, you know, like, what is this about? You know, when he gave me the note, and he said, honestly, ask him that. He's like, they're not meeting up to the quotas. They're not meeting up to the mandated stuff. And it's a joke. He's like, I am one of a handful, if that, of African-American officers employed by the sheriffs. And he said Maloney used to give his response. Andrew Maloney was the former sheriff. Now it's Patrick O'Flynn after Maloney retired. So it's something that's gone on. And back to the thing about cultural diversity. I said earlier, a social worker with a gun. The police need to be trained. And I'm sorry, you cannot have. This is a systemic problem which happens all across the country. But obviously we're talking here about Rochester. You cannot have a Caucasian officer who grew up in a predominantly white town, went to a predominantly white school, was raised around predominantly white folks, all of a sudden being placed, literally, dropped, boom, in the middle of the hood, okay, and on the east side, on the west side, all of a sudden interacting with African Americans and Latinos. You cannot. It's the makings of a bad situation just waiting to happen. This officer, even though he won't admit it, he is bringing his prejudices. Maybe I put too many S's on that. His prejudices into his job. He is bringing what he feels is his understanding of how a person or persons should react, should behave. It's two words, folks. Cultural diversity. Three words. Cultural diversity training. 9 out of 10 of these officers don't have it. People be like, wow, Davy, you kind of being rough with those numbers. No, it's obvious. It is truly obvious, and that is where the racial profiling comes in. That is why a young man, African-American man, in this city, okay, can be assaulted, his rights violated, put in the back of a police car, while another officer plays a hip-hop song with the N-word repeating in it and drives it into this man's mind, ridicules this man, puts his cuffs on too tight, abuses this man, drives this African-American young man around the city for 2 to 3 hours before even getting him to booking on bogus charges to begin with. It is not within their job. It is crossing the line. It is abusing their power. And more times than not, it's the same standard when you look back and look at the situation. It is a white officer dealing with an African-American officer. And then you have your intermingled instances where it's the black officers, such as the one in the video with Mike Mazzio, you know, showing out, like Ice Cube said in his famous song, showing out for the white cop, meaning going along with it. So there's being abuses committed in this city on a daily basis. As we speak, there is a minority in the city being jacked up, being bullied. I went to a bakery the other day before I went to Florida on Clinton Avenue. And people know Clinton is known for being mostly a, obviously a minority neighbor, but mostly a big influence on Hispanic, Latino, particularly Puerto Rican culture. And on the way out, I was stopped by a young man who recognized me, obviously from my work and whatnot. And he shared a story with me and told me that where he lives, he was jacked up by a police officer and abused, and told by the officer that if he was still standing outside that corner when he went around once more, he was gonna beat the shit out of him. And lo and behold, the young man said, I'm doing nothing wrong. And he didn't move from a public corner. And lo and behold, the officer kept his word, jacked him up, threw him against the hood of his car, searched him, humiliated him in front of bypassers and bystanders, and this is what they do. Something which was, you know, the young man was not causing any problem. He was on a corner, much like this thing where they feel they control. I had Nick Joseph years ago, and people know the name Nick Joseph. Nick Joseph years ago, okay, when he was still in the RPD, and before I successfully won a lawsuit against him, which is the result of why Nick Joseph went to Greece, and we all know the rest from there.
Another example of corrupt, abusive Rochester cops is that of the Joseph brothers. Nick Joseph and his brother David Joseph, seen here in this home video, pulling out his gun on an unarmed black man and his family during a traffic stop in the city. The Joseph brothers, along with RPD cops Thomas Rodriguez, Jason Varno, Theodore Caridi, and Lamar Cousins, all stood trial in 1998 on charges of violating a city family's civil rights by beating and falsely arresting members of the family. The jury found David Joseph, who works out of the RPD's Maple section, and Nick Joseph, who at the time worked out of the Genesee section, as well as several other cops, guilty of numerous charges of violating the family's civil rights by beating them and falsely arresting them.
He stopped in front of my house, and because he wanted to take out revenge on me having videotaped his brother David Joseph, who people will recognize the name, it's David Joseph's car that Nick Joseph was driving the day of the infamous hit and run on 390 where he sent a woman into premature labor and then ran home, or, you know, supposedly ran home and was taken home because he was under the influence of cocaine and alcohol. Nick Joseph put his gloves on to retaliate against me when YNN, which back then was our news, obtained the tape from me of David Joseph with several other RPD cops abusing a motorist. Which, this is how small Rochester is. One of the cops that I caught on tape in 97 abusing this motorist was none other than Theodore Caridi. And Theodore Caridi is the police officer that can be seen as you're looking at the screen immediately to the right, which would be Mazzio's left, at the press conference. So it's the same faces keep popping up, and it's like, you know, I love the movie Groundhog Day, and I love a lot of the actors like Chevy Chase and Bill Murray that were, you know, originally from Saturday Night Live, from the SNL crew. And it's like Groundhog Day. It's like, you know, decades pass, and the same offers keep popping up, the same names, same faces, and sadly enough, they're still abusing and doing the same thing. So I had Nick Joseph put on his little leather gloves like people saw in the incident with the ticketing of the cars and the retaliation, and basically say, this is my fucking corner. Speaking about Jay, about Child and Maple Streets, which I lived two doors down, and I grew up on Child Street in the city, right down the street from Maple Section, which is now used as a tactical headquarters. And basically say, motherfucker, the next time that I tell you to move, you fucking move. I own this corner. So this is what you have. So Shepard cannot control this. Richards cannot control this. You have cops that are taking it upon themselves. Now they're claiming they own city corners. It's incredible. And it's very reminiscent of what happened with Mario Masick and Emily Good. I'm asking you to go in the house. I want you to go in the house. No, it's not legal from the sidewalk. Yes, it is legal from the... But you know what I mean? So you have that, and you see where it becomes personal, and it stops being about what they take an oath to do. It stops being about being professional and enforcing the law, but not violating the law. My thought on that is that case right there, in many ways exemplifies what is wrong with the police department and how far they're willing to go. Like you said, this is a person who has been in the military, a business owner, a person who basically, if anything, from watching the video and from seeing an interview with him, he assisted the police at the beginning. Mm-hmm. So it was a person that was fully cooperating. But then you see how the attitudes and the rogueness on the part of the Rochester police come into play. And basically, they basically take off with violating the law, with taking justice into their own hands.
At that point in time, there was the young man moved his head again, and the police officer head goes up to the other young man. What I heard was, if you move again, I'm going to punch you in the face. When I heard that, I walked forward and I pointed and I said, you can do your job, but you don't have to do that. At that point in time, officers began to push me into my building. One of my barbers came out, got between us. I began to yell out, you guys don't have to do this. This is wrong. This is wrong. You're not going to do this. You're not going to do that. At that point in time, I was told, you know, you want to go to jail. And I said, you know, you can take me to jail, but you don't have to do this. I'm not going to allow you to do this. At that point in time, I was basically told by a Rochester police officer that I was stupid. He asked me if I was a fireman. He said, you're stupid. He then turned me around, put the handcuffs on me, two handcuffs. They put me in the vehicle, and they drove me to about a few blocks from here to Brooks Landing parking lot.
And it's interesting because one of the things that I heard Willie Lightfoot say is that it's clear that already they wanted to do a name association with him. They wanted to associate him with another Lightfoot, which has had some run-ins with, with the system and had a DWI. So automatically, they wanted to group him and to totally disregard that this person is an upstanding citizen in this community. And they wanted to basically clump him and lump him into this category. But the fact, I think the most important thing here is that, just like the conversation I had with an African American woman who me and her got into a little bit of discussion back and forth about the Emily Good case. And what I told her is that if they do this, for everybody that doesn't believe how bad it is in this community of Rochester, New York, for African Americans and Latinos when it comes to the police, my thing is, if they do this, what they did to Emily Good, who was a Caucasian and a woman, okay? And if they do this to Willie Lightfoot, who is a minority, but is a county legislator, you know what I mean? You would think, it's, in other words, what I'm trying to say is that it's clear that if they do this to two people of different, you know what I mean, backgrounds, a Caucasian woman, okay, not an African-American or Latino, but a Caucasian woman, okay, they violated her rights on her property, okay? And then you take the other end, and it's an African-American businessman, war veteran, okay, business owner, okay, upstanding citizen who's a legislator under Monroe County, you know, and you see what they did to him. And you see how they manipulated and made bogus charges, and basically, much like in my case almost, that I talked about earlier, put in to a corner where they were, where he was basically forced, you know what I mean, to be able to keep his job as a fireman. You know what I mean? As a true hero in this community, okay? Who truly, you know what I mean, unlike the police, doesn't escalate, doesn't create unnecessary situations, but truly is a person who every day puts his life on the line as a firefighter. And for them to do this to him just shows you, I mean, it's sad because I think I've become sensitized to the point where acclimated, whatever you want to call it, where it truly doesn't surprise me. It doesn't. I mean, it's like I see these cases and I'm like, you know, maybe I'll shake my head or I'll say, you know, one more, but it truly doesn't. At the end of the day, it truly doesn't blow me away. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't really, it's just more, you know. I just thank God that, like I said, you know, now more than ever, Rochester is literally on the spotlight. I mean, on a worldwide spotlight. I mean, and people are seeing it. I saw people commenting on Willie's video, you know, on the video that I caught, you know, videotaped of their retaliation, on Emily's original video, you know, and then, of course, like I said, the ticketing incident, it's just, it's, I'm glad that Rochester is really seeing it, you know what I mean? Man, it's great, man. It's I mean, I wish you could turn the clock back a little bit or turn it forward a little bit from 04. I believe my case, you know, would have benefited a lot from the social media. And like I said, I'm not exactly, you know, I don't claim to be a social media expert, so I don't know exactly like when things really, really, really started taking off. But I'm pretty confident in saying that in 04, I believe YouTube wasn't around, and if it was, it would have been very, very at a very early stage. But with social media, and it's not just YouTube. I mean, you got the Blip TV, you got Indymedia, which is great. I always take it back to one of my favorite reporters, former CBS reporter. Dan Rather, and when it comes to video, he said the camera never blinks, and I love it because taking it back to the Rodney King thing, I was assaulted here in Rochester and won a lawsuit against the RPD in '89. They stopped me four times for the same reason. My plate on my vehicle resembled the vehicle that had been reported stolen, and three times, to be honest, they were pretty professional about it. They apologized, were sorry. One lady, Cobbs Hill Park or whatever, pulled me over on Monroe and Culver Road, and she even laughed. She's like, wow, you know, sucks to be you, because the plates are really similar. And the fourth time, they beat my ass, you know what I mean? They totally left me on the curb bleeding and out of breath and, you know, half knocked out, and I won a really big settlement. They didn't even want to take it to court. And this was in 94, but my case happened in 89. So my case happened 2 years before the Rodney King thing. But so when the Rodney King thing happened, everybody, very similar to the Emily Good thing, everybody was like, oh my God. If you see some of the comments on YouTube, it's like, oh my God, Rochester is a police state. It's like, they're not, nothing against the people, I welcome their comments. They're not really saying anything that I don't know. I live here. I mean, this is not new to us. It's new to the rest of the world what happened to Emily Good, and it may be new to her herself, but it's not new. I mean, for somebody that's been born and raised in this community, I've seen it from the beginning. I saw it when before it was, you know, before Rodney King. You know what I mean? Before the Rodney King thing, it happened to me 2 years before that. So the power of video is, like I said in the DNC, and I say every interview I have, I always get it in there. It's nothing to be ignored or underestimated or in any way, shape, or form, overlooked. I love photography, too. I'm getting more and more into photography. I had a lot of fun in Florida on my trip with photography. But I'm more video. I've always done video. So that's kind of like my specialty, so to say. But I always say, people always have this phrase that's been coined, and I don't know when it started, famous phrase, a picture's worth a thousand words. And my thing is, my flip to that is, if a picture's worth a thousand words, then video is priceless. And that's what I love, because, I mean, even like the George Holliday thing, when he caught the Rodney King thing, it's priceless. I mean, just like that MasterCard or Visa commercial, whatever, it truly is priceless.
$20 secure phones to assist in staying anonymous? $5,000. Fighting legal cases across 5 countries? $1 million. Upkeep of servers in over 40 countries? $200,000. Donations lost due to banking blockade? $15 million. Added cost due to house arrest? $500,000. Watching the world change as a result of your work? Priceless. There are some people who don't like change. For everyone else, there's WikiLeaks. To find out more about WikiLeaks financial blockade and how to donate, please visit wikileaks.org/support.html.
Like the Emily Good thing. Imagine if she hadn't had that, but the same thing would have happened. Okay, everything the same, except she wouldn't have been recording. It wouldn't have been out there. It would not have become what it has become. We, right now, probably wouldn't even be doing this. So I love it. And the social media sites, it just strengthens that. It's a platform. More so than just the social media, or specifically like YouTube or whatever, is sites like Indymedia that I want to hit on. Because Indymedia is like, I have been interviewed so much by every news network that you can imagine, not only locally but even outside of Rochester. And when I sit down to see the actual broadcast of the interview, half the stuff is like I don't even remember saying, because it's been chopped up and manipulated, okay, and twisted and added and this and that it's all sound bites. So Indymedia, and even this that we're doing now, is why I've always had the utmost respect for, why I didn't hesitate to come and support the meeting, the initial meeting, which resulted in the ticketing incident. I didn't hesitate in coming to support Emily Good, because I know what it's like, and I believe in them. And I believe in Indymedia, Rochester Indymedia, for the simple fact that they are what the media is not, okay? They show the whole story. They devote a tremendous amount of effort and time into depicting and showing the real story, and to giving people whose voice otherwise would go on unheard, giving them the platform. And that says it all. So that, combined with the power of video nowadays, is a win-win. It's like a perfect combination, you know. The news, you know, are quick to, my dad, rest in peace, years ago, I love this, I have it on video, he had the cojones to go to the new jail, which everybody still refers to it as a new jail. It's actually the jail next to MCC on East Henrietta Road. But at that point, literally, it was the new jail. It was. And they had a town board meeting, and it was undersheriff at the time, Patrick O'Flynn, who I mentioned earlier, and Janet Lomax from News 10 NBC. And my dad, this is what I respected about my dad, Mario. He was watching this meeting on TV, and it was like a town hall meeting, like live meeting on News 10 NBC. And he put on his clothes and got his briefcase and got his notes. And I'm like, where are you going? And he said, I'm going to the meeting. And I'm like, okay. And that was my dad. You know, he was real spontaneous. He was just real passionate. And I had no idea what he was going to get up and ask this panel, you know, which included, I believe it actually may have included Bob Keene. And I'm not 100% sure on that, who was a former county executive years ago. But I know it was under Flynn. And there were several people on the panel. And I actually, it was like watching an Oprah show, whatever. You're watching the studio setting at the jail, and it's live. And he went in there like 10, 15 minutes into the show, but it was like an hour meeting, I believe, at least, hour show. And I see my dad in line, and my dad's actually waiting for his turn to speak. And he said it best. He got up there, and this is what I love and miss about my pops. He got up there, and he asked Sheriff, Undersheriff of Flint. He said, Undersheriff of Flint. And my dad's, which people that may remember my dad from the community, his, you know, thick Spanish accent he had. He said, why is it? He said, I have a question for you, Sheriff, Undersheriff. Why is it that every time a minority, specifically a Latino African American, say, for instance, on Clinton Avenue, is stopped for a nickel bag or a dime bag of weed, my dad said, that makes the news? And then he turned and he asked Janet Lomax, who was there, and Mrs. Lomax, part two of the question is for you. Why is it that you, representing the media, are quick to, especially on a slow news night, make this a top story? And their response obviously was wishy-washy. They kind of went around and this and that. And so why I went off on that is to prove a point, is that the media truly doesn't care other than to put their own spin. And I'm not gonna say I laugh because it's sad, but I truly shake my head and almost in a sarcastic way just say, you know, wow. When I see people like Craig Hurd's mother, who people will see on my video, RPD badges of dishonor, corruption, and murder, who had her son executed, who the media went over there, and the media was not interested in her real pain and her real story and how she felt that her son was taken from her by rogue cops, and how she felt about the process where the mayor, former mayor of this town, of this city, Mayor Johnson, and the chief, who is now lieutenant governor, who said bye-bye to Rochester because I'm bettering my portfolio by running with Mario, with Andrew Cuomo, they basically said her son's killing was justified before this young man's body was even cold. So the message that sends any potential grand juries, of course, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to guess the outcome. They didn't indict the officers, and they're still working. One is in Greece, by the way. Savichev works for Greece. I believe it's Savichev or David Pagan. But my point is that the media truly doesn't care. When I see a tragedy happen, and especially when I see a minority on News 10 or 13 or 8, it's like they're being manipulated. And you can tell. You know, the person's upset, they're crying, that there's news crew in there, they're asking the same stupid-ass questions. It's almost like news is not what I think news used to be, and maybe I'm wrong, of what it used to be, not of what it is now. It's a spin thing. Even Nancy Grace, who I know her background, and I know what happened with her, which was tragic. Basically, her fiancé was murdered, so she became an advocate for, you know, he was killed in a holdup. I understand that. But if you see the whole Casey Anthony thing and everything, okay, which we truly were not there, so we obviously the jury, this is a system we have. The jury did not buy the prosecution story. End of story. That's what it is. But if we see how even her emotions, and you question, it's all made for TV. It's all the spin. It's all get the ratings. The same thing with Jane Velez Mitchell. It's all the spin thing. And you question, you know, that's why they're so important that, you know, indie media is around. And that, you know, at least YouTube, that you can get your, you know, your point there. You can put your video. You can upload your video. And thanks to YouTube, Rochester's in a world spotlight. It's important because the media does not, the traditional media, okay, does not really care, okay, to really be an advocate for victims, to really, you know, tell the whole story. It's all sound bites. It's all left on the editing room floor. It's all spin. Even the whole breaking news thing, the music, it's become more theatrics than anything. So that more than anything, I mean, you know, I know it's a long answer, and I love to talk, but with social media, I mean, I think it's needed so much, if not for the obvious reasons, which I've already mentioned, even more so because it provides that counterbalance that is so much needed when everything you put on the news, it's like so predictable. You're not really going to get the whole story. You're going to get a lot of spin. If you put something like Fox News, you might as well just, you know, shoot your TV set. Because it's all so predictable and so sketchy, you know what I mean? That more so we need, you know, things like in the media. And then on a other not so unrelated level like YouTube or Blip TV. And I think it's just exploded, you know. And it's going everywhere. Even Netflix, which, not to go off the subject here, but even that, you know, places are reducing or eliminating their DVDs through mail. Everything is going the way of the internet. And you know, I know that statement even may sound like, Dave, wake up, it's already went. What I mean is every day it's more and more and more and more. You know what I mean? It's, you know, I'm not going to lie. I'm somebody that used to, you know, hound the local media to get this story out or this injustice or this. And I really, unless they step to me, I really tend not to go out of my way, you know what I mean, to notify them, unless it's something really, really, really important, obviously, you know. I mean, they're there, and I hate to say it, they're there to be used, because they definitely use us, and they definitely use citizens, and they almost, it's almost like they need the tragic stories. And they need to be in that living room with that African-American family or Latino family talking about this tragic incident. They're not really interested in caring for the person or really, you know, interested in getting the true pain of what this family or person is going through. It's more almost for the ratings. It's almost more to fill in that half hour. Whereas the indie media and the other social media sites provide a vehicle to truly, you know, get as real as you can get, as raw as you can get, as uncut as you can get, to the real, you know what I mean, the real story, you know what I mean, the real thing behind it, the follow-ups. Many times you see something on News 10, and you're like, oh, great, they covered it. Wow, I'm surprised that they didn't do that bad of a job at actually getting it under. You never hear a follow-up to that. So it's you know, it's just, but again, that combined with the power of video, whether it's, if you want to take it back into the 60s, like I told the DNC the other day in an interview while I was in Florida, the Zapruder film, even though I know there's 101 conspiracies to that and different theories, but even that, if Zapruder would not have been, you know, there, you know, filming it, we wouldn't have that. You know what I mean? So it's so important, and obviously I can name 100 things, but the most police-related ones, you know, the Rodney King thing was something that opened it up. Before that, I don't recall anything on that scale, you know what I mean, being caught on video. The Emily Good thing is the reason we're here now. So don't underestimate, you know, the power of video, man. It's just, I love it. I mean, I love photography, and there's stuff that you can find in a photo that you may not find in a video. But I don't know, I think I'll always be more towards the video, because it the camera truly never blinks, and it never, you know, it never stops until you press stop. You know what I'm saying? And if you let it roll, like Emily Good did, you let it roll. And by the way, that's the main reason why the charges were dismissed. It's not a secret, you know what I mean? You know, because even DA was able to see because of the video. The last thing I want to point out is, or one of the last, I mean, if you have any question, what I mean is, tied to this subject, is that a retired state police, which is in the newspaper article of July 3rd, which I believe was a Sunday in the DNC here, Dwyer, basically said, and he said it perfect, a former law enforcement officer, now I believe he's practicing law, said it best. He said, frankly, I feel it's ironic that the police is such up in arms and such an uproar about being bothered by being videotaped when there's a double standard, basically, he said, because we have shows which are huge in the American, you know, way of life and American, you know, family, like Cops. I've caught kids humming the the song to cops, you know, bad boy, you know. And it's crazy because the police, you know, like he said, if anything, video can actually help counter things or allegations of police abuse if it's seen on video. Much like the video was used in this case by the DA to say to the judge, Your Honor, Judge Elliott, we need to withdraw. There's really no basis for anything, you know, which in turn he dismissed it. So the video could actually be good. And it's hypocritical because even the thing about take back the land, the police were there videotaping. So it's a double standard, which is why Mazzio is so good at spinning, because they themselves videotape. Most cruisers, I don't know in Rochester or not, I know I went to South Carolina on the way down to Florida and everything, and you see them. Most cruisers have cameras mounted right on the cruiser. So it's not just these so-called, which by the way, I've heard it all, anarchists and cop haters and, you know, all these, you know, New World Order. It's not just so much everyone that's involved and are, endorsers of video. It's even the police themselves, you know, have resorted to video as a way of documenting and preserving stuff. On cops, you see it all the time. You'll see part of the crew and everything, then you'll see a cop with a small camera. He's doing that for his benefit. You know what I mean? And I love the too how Dwyer said it best in that article. He said that if the show Cops, which I don't believe Dave ever come here, but I know Crime 360 and other shows have come here recently. But if the show Cops were to come here, all these officers, and this is what he said basically in the article, who are complaining and who are not comfortable being in camera, or claim they're not, like Mario Masek obviously didn't like Emily Good taping them, they would be the first ones to scramble to be on the show Cops.